Our first lesson today is from 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 18 through 22. For Christ also suffered for sins once for all, the righteous for the unrighteous, in order to bring you to God. He was put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which also he went and made a proclamation to the spirits in prison, who in former times did not obey. When God waited patiently in the days of Noah during the building of the ark, in which a few, that is, eight persons, were saved through water, and baptism, which this prefigured, now saves you, not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers made subject to him. The word of the Lord.
Thank you, God.
Our second lesson is from the book of Genesis, the 9th chapter. Then God said to Noah and to his sons with him, "As for me, I am establishing my covenant with you and your descendants after you, and with every living creature that is with you, the birds, the domestic animals, and every animal of the earth with you, as many as keep on the earth. I establish my covenant with you that never again shall all flesh be cut off by the waters of a flood, and never again shall there be a flood to destroy the earth." God said, "This is the sign of the covenant that I made between you, me and you and every living creature that is with you for all future generations. I have set my bow in the clouds, and it shall be a sign of the covenant between me and the earth. When I bring clouds over the earth and the bow is seen in the clouds, it will remember my covenant that is between me and you and every living creature of all flesh. And the waters shall never again become a flood to destroy all flesh. When the bow is in the clouds, I will see it and remember the everlasting covenant between God and every living creature of all flesh that is on the earth." God said to Noah, "This is the sign of the covenant that I have established between me and all flesh that is on the earth." The word of the Lord.
Thank you.
him the good news of salvation does not begin with angels proclaiming peace, but begins in the wilderness that is full of wild beasts and demons. This is good news. Jesus was driven into the wilderness. He was in the wilderness 40 days, tempted by Satan, and he was with the wild beasts, and the angels waited on him. This wilderness is chaos. Even Jesus was tempted. If Jesus was tempted in his own wilderness, what can we expect? Let me give you an example of someone who has been in the wilderness. Brian Head Welch is the former lead guitarist for a controversial metal band called Korn, with a K. His video for I Am Second, and I know some of you might be familiar with that series, it's a series of online faith stories. And it features his transformation from junkie rock star to Christian, father, and musician. Welch's story shares the temptations he wrestled with, including severe alcohol and drug addictions, in addition to being a single father after his ex-wife overdosed. After hearing his daughter Jenea, who was 5 years old at the time, sing a Korn song, one of his songs about sex, 5 years old, he decided he needed to hit rock bottom, and he had to do something to change. He says, "My life was just like spinning out of control. God used Jenea to save me, to save her life later on. Before I found freedom in my faith, I thought I had it all. But fame, money, cars, girls, drugs, these are not the things that bring you pleasure in life. The high that comes from God's love and the understanding that it brings is the most incredible content feeling." Brian Welch has been through the wilderness. He faced wild beasts and personal demons. But he found his way to the other side. God knows that we've been tempted to give up. Some of us have given in to our pain, our misery, our self-doubt. We've all been discouraged. We've lost our faith and given up hope. We've seen wilderness fulfilled as paradise. We all have a wilderness experience. We may have had that place in our life where we dealt with beastly temptations. We may have been in valleys so deep that we thought we'd never get out. We all have our personal and not always private demons. Some of us are still in the wilderness. Maybe we're dealing with a dying marriage or dying loved one, a wayward child, or maybe joblessness, or even homelessness. It happens here. Could be our own poor health. We could be wrestling with who God is or even who we are to God. We are tested at every turn. Wild beasts of one kind or another are trying to devour us. Desperation and despair may be all too familiar. Believe it or not, I I was in the wilderness when my father left our family. I was in the wilderness as a clumsy, overweight child. I struggled in college, as many of us do. I was there in the wilderness when I got divorced and found myself raising my oldest son as a single mother. It was in the wilderness when we had a miscarriage, when I lost my favorite aunt. I'm wandering in the wilderness right now with my brother as he faces cancer. I'm there when I live with depression and anxiety. I face changes, I've been jobless, and uncertainty and loneliness. I'm in the wilderness right now. I don't know where God is calling me to be next when my time here is complete. Sometimes it seems like I will never reach the edge of my wilderness. But I know I will. Because I know that God is waiting for me. What is your wilderness? What beasts are chasing you? For me, wilderness is vulnerability, feeling that I have no control over a situation. I don't like surprises, good or bad. I don't like being caught unaware. I don't even like scary movies because I don't know what's going to happen next. I can't figure it out. But in the midst of these struggles, find faith. We find faith. Just like Jesus did. That faith is what leads us out of our wilderness. That's a tale that's told all throughout the Bible. And the good news is that God will not leave us in the wilderness alone. We have a promise that God will show up. He may not come when we want, but he'll show up right on time. That's the promise that we have to hold on to. This is the good news. Jesus was alone in the wilderness after his baptism. But we're not. Like Jesus, we have the opportunity to find our faith in God and to claim our right as children of God. We're in the season of Lent. Our journey through 40 days of prayer and contemplation that ends in the joy of Easter. Jesus came out of the wilderness and proclaimed, "The time is fulfilled and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." Like Jesus, our baptism gives us an armor to fight in the wilderness. We can overcome through prayer and by the grace of God. In Lent, we're on a spiritual journey, a quest. It's not only a time to think and pray, it's a time to prepare ourselves for our spiritual participation in Jesus' death and resurrection. It's our time to die to our old selves and be formed anew as a being that is full of the Spirit of God. many of us, our wilderness within exists when we are alone. Wilderness is present even in a crowded place. Many of us have gotten lost in the wilderness. We've been wandering for years to find a way out. But again, through the grace of God, we can learn to avoid those wilderness places. We can keep our focus on God, on the hope of the resurrected Christ, and the love that we share. We focus on the cross as the source of our knowledge about who God is and how God saves us. We can love our neighbors and ourselves, just as Jesus taught. We can look forward to the hope of Easter to be prepared for the hope of the resurrection and the transforming love and guidance of our Savior. During Lent, let us remember that we are dust, and to dust we shall return, transformed in newness of life on the other side of the wilderness. Our hymn is Thy Holy Name.